COVID-19 pandemic has affected millions of lives globally and brought with it a great deal of uncertainty and risks to economic growth. At the same time, it has also put industries in the position to face and embrace new challenges. In the eye of a pandemic, rebooting the Indian financial services sector, a leadership series by Refinitiv, partnered by ET Now, is bringing together the industry's leading voices to address key questions surrounding economic recovery and the role that the banking and financial services sector will play in it. To discuss the role regulation will play in facilitating economic recovery, Arun Prasad, Head of Sales South Asia at Refinitiv, spoke with Satish K. Marathe, Director, Central Board, Reserve Bank of India, and Surekha Marandi, former Executive Director with the RBI, on the topic, A Trigger for Change, Evolving Regulatory Frameworks for Banks, Financial Institutions and Businesses.
If you look at the stats from the International Labour Organization, 44% of the total employment in India today is related to agriculture and associated sectors. And COVID-19 is definitely impacting this particular sector. Looking at it from a regulatory framework, I think the most recent topic was the recent ordinance that paves the way for RBI to have an oversight over the cooperative sector. Now, there are over 90,000 rural cooperative banks. I would like to get your views from a regulatory perspective, from an oversight perspective. How big is this task for RBI and what are the challenges for RBI going ahead?
This ordinance, it basically covers three types of financial institutions in the cooperative sector. It is most importantly directed towards the urban cooperative banks, which number about 1,550. Then it doesn't mention so much specifically, but it simply says cooperative banks, and that's why 200 and odd, the district central cooperative banks, which we have in our country, and about 30 state cooperative banks also get covered by this. What we have, the number that you mentioned, 90,000, in fact, the number is 95,000 as far as the primary agricultural cooperative societies are concerned. They do not get covered by this ordinance, and neither does the RBI has ever regulated these institutions. There is another type of bank, the Rural and Agriculture Development Bank. In the old days, they used to be called the land mortgage banks. Now, these two institutions do not get covered by the ordinance that has now come. So typically, if we say 30 state cooperative banks, about 200 and odd district central cooperative banks, and 1,550 roughly the urban cooperative banks.
One aspect is capital raising. And I think, Ms. Manandi, you also mentioned about priority sector, you know, focusing back on the priority sector. If you kind of go back to the agriculture sector, and if you look at NABARD's financial inclusion survey report, it said that around 30% of households, especially in rural sector, they still take credit from non-institutional sources. The local moneylender can be one of that. The problem of financial exclusion also gets aggravated to some extent because of the legal framework and the documentation required. In many cases, people don't have that kind of documentation as, especially landless, you know, cultivators. What policy planning do you think is required in our economy to ensure that the rural household segment gets more and more easier access to a formal lending?
Basically, these people are invisible because they do not have any formal footprint in the formal space. So these people are invisible. So who discovers these invisible people are the NBFCs, the microfinance institutions. Yeah. And other NBFCs are actually, because the NBFC model, if you see, it's a high touch model, whereas a bank model is a low touch model. So banks will not be able to reach out to the last mile. So the NBFCs actually can reach out to the last mile, the MFIs. So in fact, RBI has now put a co-origination model of loans where the NBFC originates as well as a bank, you know, both of them can originate a loan because it is easier for the NBFC to go to the last mile because they are the high touch model. And it's a win-win situation for both. NBFCs want have low capital, high touch. Banks have high capital, low touch. So it's a sort of a, you know, and there's a lot of, I mean, it'll take some time for this model to come up because it has just been introduced recently. I think in 2018-19, it has been introduced. So it'll take some time to come up because banks have to tie up with NBFCs, and it is happening. The co-origination model is happening. So once this happens, the people who have not been included will get included.
I wanted to bring a point about MSME sector, right? So with this COVID-19, we've seen that sector, I would say, probably going through an extremely tough time, both on the supply and demand side, I would say. Capital raising has become a problem. Operating for their operations, running their day-to-day operations, getting credit, that is becoming an issue more and more. And I think we're right at the heart of that particular challenge right now in that sector. What policies, Ms. Marandi, would you propose or advise that the government should seriously look at to reboot even the MSME sector? There has to be light at the end of the tunnel, especially post-COVID-19, but also how to survive this particular phase right now.
Government has already done has put in place the fund of funds for contributing to the capital of MSMEs. And I think SIDBI already has some funds for debt, financing debt. And also I think there's a need for this distressed, fund, a sort of a distress fund in times of calamity, which was also in the MSME committee report, it was recommended. And in fact, that is much more needed now, how to help the MSMEs. And also how to help the MSMEs to adapt to these COVID-19 situations, how to build their businesses around this situation, So that also needs to be done. So a lot of capacity building needs to be done in the MSME space. So you have to have these EDCs in every districts and in every, locality for helping MSMEs to deal with all these things. There needs to be a network, of EDCs to help MSMEs not only in capacity building, but also with information, how to get help where.
When the TLTRO2 operation was carried out, which was Target Lending Term Repo Operations 2.0, TLTRO1 was oversubscribed, very successful. 2, which had the clause which says that, a part of that sum should go to NBFC. The uptake for that was quite limited. I think it was around 0.5 as per the RBI press release. Do you think there is this risk aversion that's building up in the large banks? And do you think that's a challenge? And if it is a challenge, what would be advice to the industry as a whole? How do we overcome this challenge around risk aversion?
I would go back a little on that point. See, we undertook in our country an asset quality review. And as a consequence, large accounts got identified as NPA. And then the accountability process started. And people who were really, or officers who were really not involved substantially in decision making also got hauled up, rightly or wrongly. Eventually, they would get justice and they would come out clean. But then, ever since that, the officers in public sector banks particularly are worried. They are inclined not to take substantive decision making. And that's how the risk averseness has come. Government of India is quite aware of this aspect. And in consultation with IBA and probably with RBI also, they have now come out and said, in cases where there's something wrongdoing is felt, unless it is assessed by a committee, the matters would not be, I would say, in normal course referred to the three C's as they have been talking, because the officers have been worried of three C's, the CVC, the CAG, and the CBI, all the three. So corrective steps have been taken, but it will take a little more time. What we need for the public sector banks, a new ownership and management pattern.
Thank you, Sri Marathe. I think the topic for today is really a trigger for change. And you just mentioned today, that new ownership management sector, that's really a great trigger for change.